Good morning, Hillside. It's good to see you guys. We're going to worship together, if you guys would stand. Pray. Father God, we thank you for another day. Lord, we trust you. We look to you. You are our hope and our refuge. And we've come to worship you because you're good. Just tell him you love him. We've come to serve you and worship you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's sing together. In the darkness we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Sing that again. In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Let it be your prayer. Come on. Let him hear your voice.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord.
Show us,
show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, the mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our place.
who has something to celebrate? Man. I'm a jerk, but I was a bigger jerk before Jesus. And Jesus has been doing work in me. And it's something to celebrate. Amen?
Amen.
And I know some of you guys. Are you thankful for Jesus? Man, we need him. We need him. Thank you, God, for saving us. God, even while we were yet sinners, you still died for us. You took what we deserved to the cross. We love you, Jesus. This is why we sing. We worship you, and you are good. Amen? Amen. Amen. You guys can have a seat. We're going to continue worship with communion. And today we have Geneva sharing with us, so welcome, Geneva.
Components and get ready. While you're doing that or adjusting your volume for those of you at home, I have a little story to share with you real quick. A couple weeks ago, I was cleaning up something in our patio and I opened up the garbage bin, the green one you set out to the curb, and there was a bunch of maggots from top to bottom everywhere. It was quite disturbing. I took a picture with my husband's phone to share with all my friends, but he managed to delete it. So I can share it with you guys via memory. I drew it down so you could experience this. This is what happened. This is what I saw. It's verbatim exactly, except I think there were more and much bigger. Anyway, let's talk about communion. First of all, you don't need to be a member of Hillside to partake. We just ask that you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And please don't take it alone. If you are living alone, I hope you find someone to quarantine with and just be together. I feel like we've been pushing that a lot, is, you know, safely together. And something I want to share with you guys about communion is just something that I realized month ago or so. So this time last year, I was a stay-at-home mom, and I was dealing with just not feeling good about myself because I wasn't as productive as I wanted to be. Contrary to Louie and Cassidy's messages the past couple weeks about Paul being like, look at all this stuff I did. It's garbage. It's kind of like, look at the stuff I haven't done. I'm garbage. I didn't realize I felt that way. I was just like, oh, I'm not motivated. What's happening? And then I got a job and I swept all those feelings under the rug. I kind of avoided it. And then, you know, April hit this year and I'm stuck at home again. And I'm like, I've done this before. I've got this. And then I'm dealing with these same feelings, but worse. It's like they rotted and then there was maggots growing, just like in my garbage can. I'm like, what's happening? It's so much worse. Why do I feel like garbage? And it really exploded when we did a Bible study in Mark 5:21 through 43, where Jesus is coming back from like cleansing demons, well, getting demons out of people and cleaning, healing people. And then, you know, he's going through the crowd. Jairus is like, help, my daughter's dying. Come help her. And he's like, all right, I'm going to do that. And then the bleeding lady touches his garment and he's like, who touched me? And she's like, it was me. And he's like, well, you're healed. And then, you know, people are like, oh, Jairus, your daughter, oh, she really died. Don't bother. And he's like, what do I do? And Jesus is just like, hey, I'm going to help you out. Don't worry. I'm going to heal your daughter. Boom, it's done. Well, he goes there and he's like, little girl, get up. Let's get her something to eat. Boom, it's done. And as we're talking about this, Matt's like, who do you see yourself as in this, all of this story? Are you Jairus? Are you the bleeding woman? You know, all these cool characters. And I'm sitting there like, I'm the dead girl. Like, I feel like I'm just lying here, nothing to contribute at all. And it was just like this weird realization of just like, wow, my self-worth is in what I get done instead of who God made me to be. Am I seeking him? Am I doing what he wants me to be? It's like, no, how much am I going to get done? Did I do this? Do I that? Did I clean the trash can? No, it fell off my list. And then maggots came out. Anyway, just know that our works on earth is not what makes us valuable. Jesus said, I will die for you, and that's what makes you valuable to me. I'm going to do a quick prayer, and then let's partake. Dear God, thank you so much for what you have done for us. Let us never forget your sacrifice and what that means. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you're here and you haven't already started, I would invite you to go ahead and let's take the wafer. Lord, thank you for your body that was broken for us. Thank you for the life that you give. Thank you that you're putting us back together. In your name. And the cup represents the blood that was shed, a covenant promise of how things between God and us will always be, not because of what we've done, but because of what he's done. Thank you for your forgiveness of sins, for your blood that brings healing, and the promises that you extend to us, that you fulfill. In Jesus' name.
Sing another song together.
There was a moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of Love had given up his life. The dark day in history, there on the cross he made for sinners, for every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished, but not the end we could have known. The earth began to shake, and the veil was torn. What a sacrifice was made, as the heavens roared. Oh, hail King Jesus. All was lost, he crossed eternity. life was on the move. Or in a dark old tomb, where our Lord was laid. One miraculous breath, and we're forever changed.
You, God. We thank you for your presence in our lives. We thank you for your faithfulness. And we look to you this morning, God. Thank you for your church. Pray you bless them, encourage them, strengthen them, heal them. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You guys can have a seat. We're going to continue our worship with tithes. And we have Jake. So welcome, Jake.
Hillside family. My name is Jake Whiskersh, and for those of you who don't know me, it's been a few months. And I smile because I know that we'll be back together shortly. Shortly, maybe an eternal time. It's just a blink. But for us here on earth, going several months or a year or more without interaction with our communities is very stressful, and it takes a large psychological toll. Fortunately, the spirit is greater than our psychology, and we can lean in and press in virtually, even if we can't be in person live with one another. So as much as it aches my heart not to be around people and shake hands and give hugs and celebrate, I know that we all are. And how do I know? Well, one way that I know is that our tithes have actually increased since COVID struck and our church had to close its in-person services. To me, that's just a humbling, overwhelming acknowledgement of how selfless and faithful our church community is. We're not grabbing at earthly things to stockpile them out of fear of what may or may not come. We have true ultimate faith in the Lord above to provide, because He is always faithful. He always delivers on His promises. He's never let anybody down. His provision will continue. It always has been there, and it always will be there. So that tells me a great deal about the character of our people and our congregation, and I could not be more honored to be a part of it at this juncture of my life. Why do we do tithes? Well, we want to acknowledge that God is the ultimate provider. It doesn't come from our own hands or our own sweat. It comes from Him. gracing us with his blessings. And our job, therefore, is in turn to offer those blessings to other people, knowing that he will continue to just pour into our lives. And the more we give, the more he provides. And we want to be faithful and diligent in that, preferably in a routine, but not in so much of a routine that it becomes unconscious, or that we lose perspective on why it is that we do our tithes or anything that we do as a ritual in our church community, including communion, including praise and worship, including attendance in and of itself. So I invite you at this critical juncture of everybody's life, when we're all under stress and we're all disconnected from community, we're isolating, none of which are good behaviors for human beings to experience. I invite you to remember that we are a community of Christ, and Christ doesn't go away. And even though this virus is here and it's temporarily separated us, and I really want to make a point of that, it is temporary that we are separated. It may seem like a long time, months and even a year or more. It is temporary. It will end. Jesus is always going to be there, and God behind him to support and provide for everybody. I invite your continued offerings, not just in your money and your finances to help church services continue going, but throughout your community with your time and your talents as well. Those are all blessings given to us by God. And as long as we put forward the effort to make sure that other people are receiving those blessings, God will continue to fill us with them. Thank you. I love you all. I miss you very, very much. My family misses you. My kids definitely miss you. And I'm going to stop before I start to cry. Have a wonderful Sunday. See you soon.
Sunlight plays upon her head. I hear the sound of a gentle wind on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me
that's exciting. I'm not going to do that.
What?
You will all be thankful.
That? Oh, the...
Yeah, I can't sing like that.
It's not singing. It's a falsetto, and not a good one at that, but it's mine.
Yes, that's good. Good morning, Hillside Church family. Good morning, our representation. So wonderful to see you here. We need this.
Yeah, this is like a security blanket.
There's like song sheets on here.
Three-year-olds need a binky, and I need this.
Okay. I just want to make a comment about that last song that we sang and about our risen King. And this morning I was reading in Matthew 25 and 26, and it's Peter denying Christ three times, Gethsemane, and I love reading in the Message Bible because it feels a little bit more like a story and like you're in it. And as I was reading this morning and then singing the song declaring that Christ is risen from the dead, it made me think about even what Geneva was saying, that our sight can be so short and that we cannot see or even begin to imagine or believe in what God has for us because we don't know the whole story. And that's where faith comes in. And that's where trust comes in. That's where believing that who God says he is to you, that you're his child and that he has something good and great in store for you, comes in. And those are the things that, as his people, that we are wanting to think about and to set our thoughts and our minds and our actions on the things that are true and lovely and good and faithful and produce life and joy. And so I just was really excited during that song because it's like, I do know the end of the story. I don't know all that's in that. And I love that each day is a gift from God. But I'm going to stride. I'm going to move forward. I'm going to press forward towards that. And so it was really exciting. And I hope that there was a worship song this morning that touched you in a way that impacted you to let you know that Christ is alive in you and working through you.
Yeah, I enjoyed that song as well because of the lyrics. And it talks about how he's our king. And I don't know about you, but over the last several months, I've been reminded of my own finite abilities to control things and to do the things that I want to when I want to do them. I'm very thankful that God is not limited, nor is he surprised when he looks at the circumstances that we navigate through. He simply says, can you trust me? Can you put your hope in me? Can you lean into me and know that he's going to give us what we need for what we have in front of us? If you're like me, you want to have the entire printout of everything that's going to happen for the next week, 2 weeks, 3 months. You want to know this is going to happen, this is going to happen. Jesus says, trust me. And he invites us to that because his character is good, he is faithful, and he will fulfill what he said.
So our three-year-old grandson was over yesterday, and right before his nap, he's got this area in our room that has these little boxes, and there's tissue paper, and he likes to wrap presents in there. And he had, before Louie came in the room, he had taken a little item and wrapped it in tissue paper, bright green lime, and put it in this box with a bow on it, and it's about this size, and he put it next to him, and Louie didn't know what it was. And the little boy in Louie came out. He's like, Owen, what is it? He's like, it's a present. It's already wrapped. And it just reminded me of how much you do want to know what's going to happen, but what came out, like your anticipation of what was in the box.
Well, I'm glad that entertained you.
It did. What was in the box was this little tiny remote control that goes to something that I have no idea what it goes to, but it was like an oval, slick, fits in your hand, pretty cool. And so that was fun.
And yet he kept a secret.
He kept a secret. He did. But it was more fun to watch you squirm and not knowing what it was.
Yeah, it was so much fun.
Yeah. Earlier Chris said, do you have something to celebrate? And it's like, yeah, I have something to celebrate. We had a member in our church family who this last week got very, very sick, ended up at the ER and was not COVID, but it was a grave moment. And our church family went to prayer and to bat. And I would like to say that God did a miracle within 24 hours. That man was on his feet at home, standing, eating, breathing on his own. And it was a miracle. Hands down, only God could have done what was done and breathed life in this man.
Yeah. And so.
Yes, yes. Glory to God.
Without getting into all the details, it basically came down to a very, very serious infection that at night was overwhelming. And the next day, the doctor comes in and checks and everything is normal and says, we need to send you home because there's sick people here.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
I mean, thank you, Jesus, for continuing to heal yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And then this last week, we had a virtual youth camp here.
Much harder to meet your spouse at the virtual youth camp.
There's a story behind that. But Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Cassidy was up here with four women. Joey, you've got some pictures to show. So they came up, and our district offered a virtual youth camp and with different challenges and different
speakers
and devotionals and things like that. And one of the young ladies at the camp was filled with the Holy Spirit and spoke in tongues, and that's really exciting. And just the bond, the fun, the giggles, the giddiness, it was so energizing and fun to see these girls look forward to, yes, to just having fun together. And so what Louie was saying, I said, so we were talking about this last night when we were sitting on the balcony, and I said, man, this kind of camp is really hard for people to meet their spouses. Like, I met Louie there 32 years ago. My daughter met her husband there.
Same camp.
Eight, 9 years ago. And 10 years ago.
10.
10 years. We're getting old. 10 years ago. And
speak for yourself, Grandma.
Grandma. And Louie said, do you think God is limited to not, to like people not meeting who God has for them just because youth camp isn't happening? And I said, no. He can still move and act and bring people together that, like Cassidy and Cole, like on the coffee date app, and they met each other and they had given up and then they gave it one more try. And
so far it's working out, right?
So
there you
far,
go. Okay,
yes.
Good.
Yes, they're what, a month in now? And
more than that.
Oh, 2 months in, they've been married now. So anyway, yes.
Well, I mentioned this earlier, but Cassidy's been with us for a year.
Yeah. Your assistant. Assistant yeah. to the pastor. Cassidy. Okay. So anyway, this is enough.
You need to wear more mustard. Oh, you are. You got a little mustard color. Okay, there we go.
Couple things. We are still doing online studies, online groups, and you can go to our app or our website and get more information. You can text the church phone, and Cassidy will get back to you and get you whatever information you're looking for and how to connect. And we are also encouraging you, the people that you're quarantining with, to gather together on Sunday mornings or at a time to do church that works for you and get together and worship and listen to the word together. It doesn't have to happen at 10:30 in the morning. It can happen later in the day. It could be a barbecue. It could be a brunch. It could be whatever.
A barbecue.
A barbecue. So anyway, just wanted to encourage you all with that. And do you have anything else to say, Louie?
Yeah, one of the things that if you happen to be here physically present in the building, you're wondering, are you going to pass the bags for offering? No, we are not passing the bags currently, but we have black boxes in different parts of the room. And just outside these doors, if you're interested, you can make a deposit into the black boxes. But otherwise, there's lots of ways to give. You can find it online, et cetera.
I saw Jake at Home Depot.
Nice.
And he's like, are we social distancing? He's like, no, you're a family. So that's for you, Jake. Home Depot.
Home Depot.
And he recognized me with a mask on. They were talking about that on baseball, that they're starting to recognize people with their masks on. And I'm like, I don't know how I feel about that. But
why?
I don't want to. I would like to see people's faces and their emotion and their smiles.
There's plenty of emotion and faces right here, baby.
All right. With that said, we're going to take a couple seconds. We're going to say hello and grab that cup of coffee before we come back to our teaching time. And here we go.
to crucify, the flesh must die so he can live, so he can live. Breaking free from me, break the mind, heal thy bones, refresh thy soul so he can live. So he can live. So he can live in me. So he can live in me.
All right, I want to invite you back towards a seat. We're going to be in Philippians chapter 4, continuing our series Better Together. A couple main themes that show up throughout Philippians are rejoicing in the Lord. One of the things that is good to know when we're thinking about Philippi is it was a colony that was largely populated by ex-soldiers who had received a plot of land in Philippi as a reward for good service and or as an incentive to not revolt against the current administration within the Roman government. Paul never addresses the Roman Empire. Paul never attempts to challenge people to choose Jesus over Rome. He simply puts down the very straightforward words of Jesus Christ as Lord. He invites people towards a wholehearted partnership with him in the message of the gospel good news. And he continues to encourage the Philippian church, a group of people that became very close to him as they were people he met after an especially harrowing couple of days in jail and got to see a miraculous recovery and then also get to see a really cool, neat church get birthed in this crucial city within the Roman Empire. And so as we head into Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 through 9, one of the things that we always like to do is to do a little bit of a look back into the scriptures we covered last week because they really inform the scriptures that we're talking about this week. And in Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 through 21, one of the challenges that Paul gives to the inhabitants of Philippi, these people who are a part of the church, he says, I want you to remember that our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Savior from there, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, for a person who was a citizen of the Roman Empire, it provided almost a gold card of opportunity, a gold card of privileges, a gold card of rights that throughout the entire empire that allowed them to really to live and to function and to travel in ways that people who were not citizens could not. And it was something that it kept Paul from being killed multiple times. It kept Paul from receiving unjust beatings, even though he got a few unjust beatings. It kept him from receiving a few along the way. We even find out that some people became citizens only by paying exorbitant amounts of money. So when Paul's talking about, remember, our citizenship is in heaven, he's speaking to something that would be a direct challenge to what the Roman Empire says is the most important citizenship you can have. They're saying the most important citizenship you can have is a citizenship in the Roman Empire. We're the biggest, we're the baddest, we're the toughest. This is how you guys can feel like you really belong. You will have everything you need if you're a citizen of Rome. And Paul, in just a little declaration, says, you know, remember, we're citizens of heaven awaiting a Savior from heaven, the Lord Jesus Christ. How does this affect us? It affects our priorities. It affects our values. It affects how we engage with other people. Instead of going around insisting on our own rights, because really, if you are a citizen of the Roman Empire, it'd be almost like if, imagine, back in the day when you could go to sporting events or to Disneyland or to places that were, you know, lots of people going to gather, it was almost like being a Roman citizen got you a fast pass. It got you cutsies, okay? My brother has the kind of a job where he and his company do backstage passes, and they provide credentialing for sports teams, for college universities, for concerts and things like that. And there was a particular time I went to a 49ers game, and I had an all-access pass. And I just hung that baby around my neck. And me and four of friends walked into, at this time, it was Candlestick Park. It was back before they'd moved down to Santa Clara, how they call them, San Francisco and Santa Clara. Anyway, that's another issue. But we just walked in, and there's people waiting in line. There's people tailgating, and people are everywhere. But very few people are getting into the stadium like we are. And we were instructed, just walk up to the guy who's standing there with the stick. It was kind of one of those sticks to keep people at bay. He says, just show them your pass. And so I'm always leery of just show them this. It'll be just fine because I've come in contact with a couple people who didn't get the memo. They were supposed to let people through. And so I don't like to insist upon my own way, but it's like, it's almost like a don't you know who I am type of a thing. So I walk back and I've got the all access pass and it's like, yeah, come on through and wave you through and see all these people like, man, I wish we had that all access pass. And it's like, yeah, no, it's pretty cool, huh? And we got $50 in food vouchers too, woo! You know, that type of a, no, not to brag, but brag. To be a Roman citizen provided that type of access. It provided that type of privilege. And for Paul to say, remember, we are citizens of heaven, he's inviting these Roman soldiers, he's inviting the inhabitants of Philippi to consider that though they may be citizens of the Roman Empire, the highest point of citizenship that we can have is our citizenship in heaven through Jesus Christ by faith and grace. And as a result of being a citizen of heaven, being a citizen who is waiting our Savior, Jesus Christ, we're not going to be insisting on our own way. The whole chapter of Philippians chapter 2, especially the first 10 verses, talks about how being a citizen of heaven, we're like Jesus, we don't insist on our own rights, but instead we choose to become servants, even to the point of obedience and even to the point of suffering, as Jesus did. So as we're waiting on our Savior, this informs where we're headed into chapter 4. I'm just going to read the first 3 verses, and then we'll dive in. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, you whom I love and long for, my joy, my crown, stand firm in the Lord in this way, dear friends. I plead with Euodia and Syntyche to be of the same mind in the Lord. Yes, and I ask you, my true companion, help these women since they have contended at my side in the cause of the gospel along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers whose names are in the book of life. First of all, therefore, stand firm in the Lord. Because you are citizens of heaven, it shows you how we would then, what kind of strength we would stand in. We're not standing in our own strength. I'm not standing in the strength of Louis. Instead, as a citizen of heaven, I am choosing to stand in the strength that comes from the Lord. This means that I have an ability to stand and to remain standing that goes beyond my normal circumstances. This kind of declaration to me is a very special one because if I was to say life verse, if I could pick one out, it was one that was assigned to me by a prophetic man named Dick Mills who, you know, Joni and I were in a place called Winters, California, visiting our dear friends, the Chumleys, and we went to a leadership meeting at a church we're not even a part of. You know why we did that? Because I had the all-access pass to that wasn't it. We were invited just to go in to sit. And so we're sitting there waiting for the meeting to be over, and this man named Dick Mills has Joni and I stand up. And he reads a verse about a man named Shammah who was working in a field of lentils. and he's surrounded by other people who are working in this field of lentils. And it says, and then the Philistines, I don't know if it's supposed to be Philistines or Philistines, but a Philistine sounds tougher. The Philistines showed up, especially if you say it in a British accent. The Philistines arrived, and they began to wage war, and it was really bad. Everybody bailed except for Shammah, and Shammah stayed in the field, and everybody left. And it says, and Shammah resisted the Philistines, and he conquered them, and the Lord gave him a great victory because he stood. And then Dick Mills says to Joni and I, this is you guys. You're supposed to stand. And you're going to come out the other side smelling like roses. And then he tells everybody in the room, tell them they're going to come out smelling like a rose. And I'm like, I'm going to come out smelling like a rose. But the whole thing was about standing. So when I see something that says stand firm, this is in my bloodline. This is in the call God's put on my life. And this is in the people who God has placed in my family. This is something that becomes a part of their call too, to stand firm. And so for us, when we're called to stand firm in the Lord, it's something where we're not having to be obstinate or difficult or stubborn. We're simply saying, I'm going to put my feet upon the foundation that is Christ Jesus, and I'm not going to turn to the left or to the right, and I'm not going to be shaken by the circumstances that are going on in the world. When everything is going the way it should go in the world, a lot of times we can almost think, and we can think, what I know where church is important, my relationship with Jesus is important, but you know, life is good. But our faith is made for times when everything is shaking. I too, like Jake was talking earlier during our tithe video, I'm looking forward to the day when we can feel much more normal in our interactions with each other. I don't know that there's ever a going back to before, because even if everything were to return to exactly how things were in February of this year, it's still... The 49ers lost the Super Bowl, and so it's a bad year anyway right there. But in the middle of it, these last several months have left a mark on us. Just like when a tree is growing, when it experiences a trauma or a hard winter or a drought or there's an attack of the killer bugs, there it shows in the rings of that tree's life. These months that we have been navigating through quarantine and stay at home and uncertainty and virus this, virus that, all the things working and essentiality and who's essential, who's not, but all that business, they've left marks in the rings of our life. And to think that they're not going to is being silly a little bit. Standing firm in the Lord allows us to know that we can hold on to a constant and persevering value and ethic that comes from Jesus Christ. Instead of everything being situational and fluid and not knowing how we're going to respond, there's a great thing being able to say, Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever, and that is my goal, that is my hope. So, number one, stand firm. What is my basis for standing firm? I'm standing firm in the Lord. Secondly, I want you to be united in the Lord. The encouragement here is be of the same mind. Paul is addressing a specific conflict in the church at Philippi. Anybody glad that Hillside, we never have personality conflicts with anyone here ever? There's never a challenge, ever. No one ever does, right? Okay, just sit, nod your head. Yeah, bobblehead me. Yeah, no, wherever there are people living in relationship, there will be the opportunity for violation to take place. And even if it's not intended, I can guarantee you this, there will be times where I will violate your feeling, I will hurt your feelings. Whether it be, it's going to definitely not be on purpose, but it's simply because when we're walking in relationship, if you're living authentically, there's going to come times where somebody makes a choice to do one thing and it hurts someone else's feelings. I'm not talking about intentionally trying to do harm. I'm talking about if you say, hey, we wanted to invite you over to come and eat nachos and watch football. You know, by faith, there's football. It's like, you know what? I've already got a plan to do that. It's like, well, I can't believe you already had a plan and you're not going to be here and you're not going to come over. That really hurts my feelings. It's one thing to say, well, I've already got a plan. I can't come. It's another thing to say, if your house was the last house in a burning world and it was the only place that was safe, still, I would not allow myself to cross the threshold into the place where you live. It is that depth of enmity which I feel towards you. That's harmful. Okay? That would be destructive. That's attempting to do damage to people. And there's a huge difference between attempting to do damage and simply making a choice that may be different than what somebody else would want you to make. So in this situation earlier, if you flash back to Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, Paul very specifically, in a general kind of way, said, hey, if we're in points of conflict, here's some things I urge you in your interactions with each other. So he's going from general to specific. In Philippians 2, 1 through 4 says, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness or compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. Speaking in generalities, he's in being of one mind is not becoming like the Borg, if you're a Star Trek Next Generation fan, where there's only one thought that's allowed. No, being of one mind means unity. It means a willingness to get along. It means mutual submission out of reverence to God. It means a willingness to engage with each other and to not insist on our own ways, not to be the bull in the china shop and stomp on each other's feelings on purpose. It has to do with not insisting on making something that's not the main thing the main thing. When we gather, our main goal in gathering is not politics. It is not anything that would potentially be an affinity other than Jesus Christ. He is the one that we are gathered here for. And that's why we have a variety of people to call Hillside home. It's because though there's many opinions and there's many strongly held convictions, Jesus is supreme and above and over every single one of them. He's our example that we're following. Okay, so when he's talking about let's be united in the Lord and let's have the same mind, it's not to be that there can't be other thoughts. It's we're not going to be contentious with each other because we're going to choose something different. We're going to be like Jesus, and it doesn't even mean not addressing when there's conflict, but it's not being a person who's looking to continue to wage that kind of relational warfare. If everywhere you go, you come in conflict with people, it could be an opportunity to look in the mirror and recognize that it's you as a common denominator. I can remember having a conversation in my office years ago, and the person who was talking to me, conversation is such a strong word, it implies we're going back and forth. And this individual was letting me know about all the reasons why she'd been violated over and over at Hillside, and then she'd been violated at her previous place. And I'm thinking, wow, what a consistent point of experience you've had with your life. Everywhere you go, you have the exact same experience. And it doesn't even matter that every place you go has a rat, whether it be church, you're going to college, you're experiencing, you know, you're working at this particular place. Everywhere you go, you have the exact same experience, and people are just rejecting you and treating you poorly. And the question that ended the conversation was, have you considered that the only thing that is in common about everything you've just mentioned is you? And that wasn't a, okay, sucka, you're a mess and you better deal with it. It was an invitation to consider that if I'm having an experience of being at odds with people every single day, everywhere I go, that maybe I could be functioning in a way to be an antagonist towards others. What are you going to do with that? Part of it is you have to then be willing to find a safe individual or two. Sometimes it's a therapist. Sometimes it's a dear friend who will speak the truth to you in love and say, hey, what do you see in me? And sometimes they'll tell you what you want to hear, and other times they'll say something along the lines, something that was said to me years ago. You're one of the most negative, angry people that I know, and it's really hard to be around you. And I'd be like, no, I'm not. I'm not negative. You're terrible. I don't even want to be your friend anymore. Go away. If you love me, you'd never say. No. At that moment, I was taken aback because the person had nothing to lose by saying this to me. Looking at it and thinking, so are you saying all the conflicts I have are my problem? It's like, you sure have a great way of escalating your conflicts. Scripture tells us when people are coming to try and put wood on the fire, Proverbs chapter 26 says, without wood, a fire goes out. My dad used to tell me all the time, having three little brothers, the temptation to respond to antagonism, it almost felt like an obligation, maybe even a vocation I could have engaged in, where they keep coming at you. And he would say, no, you are not bound by anything where you have to respond. Don't put wood on the fire. If someone's trying to stoke the fire and they're inviting you to join in with the contention, you don't have to do that. Paul says in another place, to the best of your ability, be at peace with all people. Well, doesn't that mean that sometimes people are going to assume wrongly about me, that think I'm just a pushover? It's like, yeah, they thought that with Jesus too. You know what that's called? It's called meekness. It's called controlled strength. The individual who's completely out of control all over the place isn't the strong one. It's the one who maybe could respond in strength but chooses instead to come alongside and to come under in an attitude of compassion, kindness, and mutual submission. Does that make sense?
So that's on us. Paul goes very specific when he's inviting two particular people who've been called partners in ministry of the gospel. These are not people who are just like, yeah, they go to the church at Philippi, but man, you know, they're those kind of people. They're messed up. They're not with Jesus. No, he says, their names are written in the book of life. These are people we've partnered in the gospel with. And when I look at those two names, I don't normally know how to pronounce those. E-U-O-D-A, and then there needs to be more vowels in the second word. But so I looked up in Blue Letter Bible, which is a concordance online, and I clicked on this particular verse, and it says this one lady's name is Euodia, there it is, Euodia, and Suntuke. And so when I sound really smart, like, wow, he knows how to pronounce biblical things, it's because I read it in a pronunciation guide for how do you pronounce these words that are impronounceable to me. Okay? So anyway, he's talking, saying, I plead with these ladies. I plead with you, Euodia. Euodia. I plead with you, Euodia, and I plead with you, Suntuke, that you would be united, be of one mind in Christ. We don't ever get to hear what the conflict was. It would be nice to know what they fight about in the first century. What was going on that would potentially separate these two women who've been partnering in ministry? We don't know. All we know is that they're being challenged to be of the same mind in the Lord. And then, what's funny here is Paul references, it says, I ask you to my companion or my yoke fellow, my partner, to help them. And the word here is probably also a given name. And it is S-Y-Z-Y-G-O-S. Syzygus. Syzygus. It's something like that. And he goes from talking, addressing everybody, to the singular, so we know he's talking to somebody, and he's saying, I'm pleading for these two ladies to work it out. And by the way, can you hook a brother up and help him out, oh Syzygus? Can you help them? Can you help them redeem the perspective of who they are and whose they are? Can you remind them that coming through challenge and extending and receiving forgiveness and grace with each other is one of the greatest things that builds relationship. I can tell you, most, if not all of my dearest friends, there is a moment where there was a crisis, where there was a conflict that could have caused a great split. But with kindness and compassion and forgiveness on the other side, instead we come out the other side and we realize our relationship is deeper and stronger than it was before. Just like when a bone is broken and it reheals, when it's set right, it can become stronger than it was before. A relationship that can endure conflict and can endure disagreement and can endure challenges in Christ, in compassion, in forgiveness, is a much stronger relationship. One of the things that the enemy wants to do is to drive people who call on Jesus as their Lord and Savior apart. John chapter 17 speaks about the unity of the brothers and sisters in Christ that Jesus prays for. I read that today in my Bible reading. John 17, he says, I'm not just praying for the people that are here. I'm praying for them, anyone who will ever know me, that they would be unified, God, as you and I are unified. Resist the temptation to be at odds over a long period of time with other Christian brothers and sisters in general. Because not only does it undermine our weakness, but it's exactly falling into the trap the enemy wants us to fall into, to be at odds with other brothers and sisters. The people down the street worshiping in their own way today for Jesus are not the enemy. Okay, it's not another denomination. It's not another congregation. That is not the enemy. If someone leaves Hillside and ends up going to South Reno, or they end up going to Valley View, or they end up going to Grace Church, or they go to Summit, or they go to any of the other 500 and some churches that are in Reno, it's not like we have to feel, oh man, I'm so sad that they've gone there. We lost them. It's like, no, they're just going to a different room. And if God is moving them on, he's not going to complete the work that he started him. He's not going to like stop it all. He's going to keep doing what he was doing. Our enemy is not other Christians. It's not other churches. Our enemy is the devil who wants to steal from us, to kill us, and to destroy us, to bring disunity, to bring suspicion, to bring hatred, to bring animosity, to bring jealousy, to introduce those very base flesh emotions and feelings into the world in here. And Paul and your pastor are inviting us to something different than that, that we don't have to function in that way. Okay, where we're going now is into the command and promise section of Philippians.
few weeks ago we reviewed, there's going to come times when we're reading a scripture and there's a command. This is something that we're supposed to do. It's not something that God's going to do for us. He says, I want you to do this. But then after that, there comes a promise. This is what I'm going to do. What are we supposed to do if we see a command? We do it. We put it into practice to the best of our ability. We ask God for clarity. What does it look like to put this into practice? And then we do it. What do we do with a promise of God? We receive it and we believe it. And in some ways, it's being done without strings. It's not a, oh, I see here's a promise from God. I'd like you to fulfill this in this particular area of my life. And I'm sorry for the visual, but I really like back scratches from my wife. And when I ask her to scratch my back, I have a very specific place on my back that I want her to scratch. But if I ask her to scratch my back, I am just trusting that somehow she's going to know and she's going to get there. Because I've got this massive scar on my back from a surgery I had when I was about 25. It looks like I was attacked by a shark. And for little kids, I'll actually tell them that's what happened because they'll believe just about anything. Sorry. But it's like if I invite Joni to scratch my back, unless I say, hey, will you please scratch the shark bite on my back? She plays along. Okay, she knows it was an actual shark. It's like scratching this one particular area. But if I invite her to scratch the entire thing, just go ahead. She's going to scratch where she sees fit. When we invite God to do what he's going to do and take him at his word and to believe what he says, he's going to work his stuff in our life in the places he believes we need it, not just where we want it. Could it be that Jesus knows what we need even more than what we feel we think we need? We can say, here's the felt need. No, there's the guy who Jesus encounters that's blind. And he comes up to Jesus and Jesus says, what do you need me to do for you? Everyone else would be like, here's the blind guy. He wants you to heal him. Jesus knows there's greater needs than blindness. There's greater needs than being lame. There's greater needs than a sickness. Our name being written in the Lamb's Book of Life and walking with him, that's the greatest need. Forgiveness of sins, that's a great, great need. Jesus knows what we need even far better than we do. Let's look at this. Commands and promises. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. The command here, once again, it showed up in Philippians chapter 3. It showed up a couple other places. Finally, rejoice, be glad, rejoice exceedingly, thrive. Where? In the Lord. Find your joy in your relationship in the Lord. Joy does not come from good circumstances. It comes from identifying and our identity being in Christ, in his character, in his provision, knowing that he's the one who's going to sustain us. When we're called to rejoice in the Lord, we get to celebrate who God is and what he's done. We get to remind ourselves of his character, his faithfulness, his wisdom, his provision, his compassion, his grace, his peace. Finding joy in the Lord is acknowledging him as our source, the one in whom we're rooted. And really, this kind of joy is a safeguard. It is a safe spot. It's a protection. There's many ways that rejoicing in the Lord works in us and it works through us and around us. But it takes our eyes off of the circumstances and it puts them on who he is and what he's done and what he's going to do. It's very easy to look at current circumstances and think there's a lot to worry about. Nothing is new under the sun. So with the invitation to be a person, day, nothing bad happening. It's the chaos and the wind and the waves and skies and the lightning's coming, and you still find there's this little section where there's a couple of birds sitting in their nest just enjoying life. The peace that goes beyond circumstance is what Jesus comes to give us. In John chapter 14, he says, I don't give you peace like the world gives you. Instead, I give you peace that remains. The peace he wants to deposit inside of us that guards our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus is not something that is fleeting, that as soon as we feel like, you know, we've left the room or we've walked out of the building or we prayed the prayer that somehow it's over. That peace remains with us. So how do we get that peace? We believe it and we receive it. That is the promise of God. And it's not even, Lord, I really need peace with my finances. No, really, when it comes down to it, maybe it'll be in finances where Jesus meets you. But it's like that back scratch. He's going to come and he's going to give you exactly what you need for when you need it in the place that you need it. Our job is to believe it and to trust him, that he is working on our behalf. Does that make sense? Oh, good. Philippians chapter 4, verses 8 and 9, the last couple of verses we're going to do. Finally. Paul says finally a lot. He's a good pastor. As I close, 25 minutes from now. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Get off the hamster wheel of worry and anxiety, pondering present and potential problems. I did not mean for all those to be peas, but it just happened. Pondering present potential problems. Instead, embrace the great exchange. Think on, dwell on, meditate on these things. And Paul doesn't say, think about bunny rabbits and unicorns and rainbows. He says, no, I want you to think about in your own life whatever is true. Think on that. Whatever is noble, pursue that. Whatever is right, think on that. Whatever is pure, think on that. Whatever is lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy. Those are the types of things that if you dwell upon them, something good comes out of it. It's the opposite of the anxiety that just gets you stuck on this wheel that goes around in circles. Thinking on the true, the noble, the right, the pure, the lovely, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy actually does a work inside of us that is like planting a seed that then Jesus can water and cause to grow. And those things grow up inside of us. Think on these things. It's not a don't think about bad stuff. It's here's the stuff I want you to think about. Growing up, one of the hardest commands that I think you can give to a kid is just don't do that. And it's not because don't do that is a bad idea, because most of the time when a kid's trying to do something, they need to be told not to do it, because there's consequences or circumstances. I'm not saying they shouldn't be able to explore and have fun like that, but if a fork and a light socket are involved, it's okay to intervene. Huh, Joey? We didn't even know he burned his hand until we saw the blisters. Like, what happened? Remember when you told me not to put my fork in the light socket? Yeah, I did. It's like, oh, my son. It's thinking about the stuff where when we're told what to do, it's like, it's not what don't we do, then what can we do? If we look at our relationship with Jesus as a, just don't do that, just stop it. Stop it. It's the best life to lead following Jesus, but stop it. Just don't do that. 613 commandments, 350 of them are negative. The religious leaders come to Jesus, which one's most important so we can know which one to follow? Come on, teacher, tell us. He doesn't tell them, don't do this. He says, I've got two do's for you. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. Do that. Paul's not just saying, don't think about white elephants. Stop thinking about white elephants with pink trunks. Don't think about them. He's not doing that. He's saying, don't think about that stuff. Instead, here's where I want you to let your mind go crazy. True, right, noble, pure, compassionate, admirable, excellent, praiseworthy. You can think about anything as if it falls into that category. It's the illegal, immoral, unbiblical. If it's not, think on those things. There's something in here that is a prayer and a hope that I have for me, but also for every other person in this room, everybody who's hearing this. Whatever you have learned, whatever you've received, whatever you have heard from me, whatever you have seen in me, do this. Can you say that to people? Sometimes. If you're like me, sometimes. There's definitely certain things I can say, I'm really sorry about what I did. Don't do what I was doing. Instead, let's aim to do this together. But Paul's saying, for people who belong to Jesus, our goal is to live in such a way as to say, watch what I'm doing and do what I do. That's not cocky. It's not like because I'm a super apostle. He clarifies it more in 1 Corinthians 11. He says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Why do we need to imitate someone else? So we can learn, how does this work? How does it go? Having a preschool, kids 0 through 6 years of age here at school, we get to see the monkey see, monkey do principle all the time. We get to see follow the leader happening all the time. And the way kids learn is they get to watch it, they get to put it into practice, and then they get to do it. It's not that they just go figure it out. In kindergarten, My therapy session is starting right now. In kindergarten, we were supposed to make little paper chains. And the chains are supposed to actually, one side and another side, and you put them together and you staple it, and then you take another one, you hook it through, and you put those together and you staple it, and you end up with this actual thing that looks like a chain. But the teacher took such a long time to explain it, and granted, I started school when I was four, and I was much less patient than I am now, if you can imagine. I was a piece of work. And I'm sitting there, Mrs. Morris, can you please tell me what to do? She's like, I'm helping so-and-so. And I decided I was going to start. I was going to figure out how to make these chains. And so what I started doing, I grabbed some glue, because glue sticks are good. And they smelled like cinnamon, and it tasted good. And you take the little strip of paper, and I rubbed glue on it, and I took another piece of paper, and I put it on the glue. And pretty soon I had a line of paper that was about 10 feet long. They didn't look like chains. They weren't interlinked with each other. They were just kind of glued together. And she turned around and was like, Louie, what are you doing? And I said, making a chain? She says, do those look like a chain? It's like, no, but I didn't know what to do, so I just did this. And she said, do you really think you should do things you don't know what to do? And I said, probably not. And I guess, is that the right answer? Is that the wrong answer? But it stuck with me. You know, that's 46 years ago. And I'm still thinking about, it's not that every time we can't go out and be creative and try new things, but sometimes we need to wait to actually see something in practice. What does it look like to go make a disciple? How are you supposed to make a disciple? What does it look like? Is there a program we're supposed to go through? Well, for only $29.99, Jesus says, you can download this and then do this to people and everything will be great. No, he's basically inviting people to, as you go, teach them what you've learned. You don't have to come up with the curriculum so much as you get to share with people what you've learned along the way. And for people in the Philippians, he says, hey guys, remember when I was with you? If you saw anything good in me, if there was anything that was helpful, do that. Put it into practice. And may that be true of us. That we're people who can say and who will say, if you don't know what to do, if you see anything good in me, do that. If you see stuff that's messed up, don't do that. The end of that verse, and the God of peace will be with you. Jesus will always accomplish his part. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you give us commands and promises and that you're the one who fulfills your promises. I would ask that as we take steps every single day to put into practice what we learn and to follow you, to imitate others as they imitate Christ, I ask, Lord, for a great confidence and a faith to continue to trust and believe that you will accomplish your end of the promise, that you will work in and through and for us in grace and peace and joy and kindness and courage and boldness, that those things will be worked into our character, into the fabric of who we are. Lord, not so that we can look back and think, wow, I'm doing so great, but we can see that you are actively building us, that we are not going to be people who are subject to just random fear and anxiety and be plagued by worry, but instead by putting our trust and our hope and our thoughts and our mind on your word and on your instructions, we can navigate through even the most heinous, difficult, painful, fear-inducing situations firmly with our eyes fixed upon you, trusting that you're going to accomplish what you say you're going to do, and that even if the world's going to hell in a handbasket, you're going to cause us to be able to navigate through because you're with us and you're never going to leave us or forsake us. I pray a special pouring out of your peace upon our hearts and minds today. Lord, the peace that guards us regardless of our circumstances, regardless of what's going on. Lord, you know what each person here is experiencing. You know what they're navigating. You know what anybody who's hearing this is wrestling through right now. I thank you that your words are yes and amen. And when we trust and we believe and we put into practice the belief part of trusting that you're going to bring about what you say you're going to bring about, you will do it. And you are a sure thing, and we thank you for that in Jesus' name. With nobody looking around, I just want to invite you, if you're a candidate for God's peace that guards hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, I just want to invite you to join me in lifting your hands. So you raise those hands up and say, Lord, I need your peace. I need your peace for whatever. I mean, you may have an entire list of what you think you need it for. God knows exactly what you need it for. He knows you. He knows intimately what you're navigating through. And he's not far away wondering what decisions you're going to make. He's inviting you. Don't be anxious about anything. But in everything, present those requests to me with thanksgiving, and I'm going to take care of the rest. I'm going to give you peace. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You see hands around this room raised up to you. You are the peace giver. You're the one who brings life. Work those things into us, the very fabric of who we are. You can put your hands down. Lord, we thank you that when we come to you, we can know that you hear and you respond. And I would ask for people, if they know you, if they haven't ever met you yet, if they would call upon your name, they would know that they would receive salvation as they would turn away from their way of living and begin to follow after you. I just invite you, Holy Spirit, to do your work in us in reminding us that we can call upon your name and we will see salvation. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're coming down to the end of Philippians. But really, this that we heard today, I would say, is one of the main two sections of the book. Philippians 2, where it says, don't consider your own opinions and desires the most important thing, but instead be like Jesus and come to be a servant and lay down your life in the same way he did. The second thing is, let's rejoice in the Lord. Let's take our anxiety and submit that along with requests to God and trust that he's going to intervene. He's going to give us the peace that that guards our hearts and minds in him. That's the crux of this. As we go today, think about rejoicing in the Lord. And what does that look like for you? What does it look like to remind yourself of what his character's like? What does it look like to see the peace of God, not just coming into an area of your life, but seeping down into every area of life? Every morning in my coffee, I put something called a medium chain triglyceride oil, MCT8 oil. It's a really healthy fat, and I really just absolutely love it. It fills me up, but it also gives me energy. It's good stuff. If you spill it, it's the worst. And so I don't want to spill it because I can spill a little bit and not be bothered by it. But I know a woman who I live with. She's mostly okay most of the time. She doesn't like to find oil in cabinets. But if you spill a little bit of MCT oil on the counter above where our coffee machine is, we've got two drawers underneath it and two cabinets underneath that. And oil has a way of just kind of spreading out and oozing. Anybody ever spilled oil before? Okay? It just kind of gets everywhere. And if there's a crack, it finds the crack. And if there's a loose little opening, it finds the opening. And I can remember years, maybe it was yesterday, my wife was in the kitchen, and it's like, did you spill MCT oil? It's like, why do you ask? It's just because there's some on the counter and in the drawer and in the cabinets.